Randall Carlson is a master builder and architectural designer, teacher, geometrician, geomythologist, geological explorer, and renegade scholar. He has more than four decades of study, research, and exploration into the interface between ancient mysteries and modern science. He's been an active Freemason for over 40 years and is past master of one of the oldest and largest Masonic lodges in Georgia. And very soon, he'll be launching a brand new podcast called Squaring the Circle. Randall Carlson, welcome back to Coast AM. How are you?
Oh, I'm fine, Richard. Thanks for having me back.
My pleasure. My pleasure. All right. So I always like to begin with some definitions. And I want to begin with what we mean by the great year.
Well, the great year. Okay. So most ancient cultures that we know of had a concept of cyclical time. I guess you could contrast that with our modern conception of time, which tends to be more linear. We're, you know, in fact, we can see in the Judeo-Christian tradition, we've got the beginning, the genesis, and then we've got the conclusion of all things from a beginning point and an ending point. But many of the ancient traditions, again, saw things in a more of a cyclical fashion. And there have been a number of different lengths of time that have come down to us from various traditions as to how long one of these grander cycles were. I think the one that is most likely the most credible is the model put forward in the book Hamlet's Mill. And that book was published in 1969, and it presented the idea that that the ancient peoples, many of them, looked at the processional cycle. And I'll explain what that is in a minute. But the processional cycle yielded a length of time of close to 26,000 years. And if we look at modern science, I think you and I have talked about this, Richard, if we look at the findings of modern science, to a large degree, it's interesting that some of the events that have occurred over, let's just pick a sort of a random period of time from like 100 to 200,000 years. And that's maybe not so random because we have fairly detailed records of global change going back, 200 to 250,000 years, actually much longer than that. But as the further back we get, the less degrees of precision and clarity we have. So, but from the various ice cores is one way that we have of reconstructing the past. The some of the cores taken from Antarctica go back as far as 800,000 years. The ones from Greenland tend to go back around 250,000 years. So I'm going to take that as a framework for thinking because for the most part, the resolution of those ice cores is fairly distinct and easy to discern because ice cores, almost like tree rings, they accumulate each year because of the resulting fall of snow. The snow converts ultimately into glacial ice, and it leaves it a distinct layer. And those layers can be counted, and they can be analyzed. And in the analysis of those layers, it will disclose quite a bit of information. For example, frozen within those layers of glacial ice are bubbles, and those bubbles have entrapped the composition of the atmosphere at the time they were formed. So that's one thing. Now, there are some irregularities in there that have to be taken into account because there could be errors that creep in, or contamination, rather, and so that has to be taken into account. But nonetheless, one can still get an idea of what was going on in the atmosphere at the time that layer of glacial ice was formed. And one of the things that can be determined from that is the temperature, the ambient temperature in the area adjacent or near the ice sheet. So, and that is based upon the analysis of oxygen isotopes. And I'm not going to try to get into explaining what that is. When I do a podcast where I have visual access. I usually can show some graphs and charts that make it pretty clear what the oxygen isotope ratios can tell us. But essentially, you've got two types of oxygen, oxygen 16 and oxygen 18. Oxygen 18 is heavier. So when you have a colder climate, there's less energy to evaporate ocean water, and the composition of the ocean water is going to be partially based upon its temperature. Now, when you have a lot of energy, like in a warming climate, what will happen is more of the heavier oxygen molecules are lofted into the atmosphere and then precipitate out as either rainfall or snowfall. Whereas when the energy is less available, like during a period of cool climate, more of the heavier oxygen, the oxygen 18 isotopes, get left behind in the ocean water. Now, a couple of things is that you can look at the composition of the ice, and you can look at the ratios of oxygen 16 to oxygen 18, and that will tell you, that will be a proxy. That's the term proxy. It represents the temperature. At the same time, in the oceans, the forams and the creatures in the ocean that create shells, the same oxygen isotope that's in the water of the ocean gets incorporated into the shells of these microscopic creatures. When they die, they drift to the bottom and they form layers of mud, basically, on the sea floor. Well, those forams, as they're called, can be analyzed, and the ratio of the oxygen 18 to oxygen 16 in the ocean water can then be determined. And again, that will be a proxy for the temperature of the ocean water. So what I'm getting at here is that there's multiple ways of determining when there are shifts in climate, when there are shifts in environment, and so on. Well, what's to me very interesting, where I'm going with this, is that when we utilize these various techniques, these evolving techniques of dating ancient events, what we're seeing is that it appears that the more we learn, the more there's a correlation between our modern data of shifting climates and shifting environments and global changes in the ancient model of the same thing, the change in environment. Now, I mentioned the time span 26,000 years. Well, that comes from a number of different sources, one being the book that I mentioned, Hamlet's Mill. And anybody who's interested in this kind of information is probably a good place to start, because that is considered kind of a seminal work as far as laying out two ideas. One, to elucidating the concept of cyclical change that was preeminent in the worldview of the ancient peoples, and the other, that it was tied to astronomical cycles. And I'm going to read a little quote here from Hamlet's Mill, and I will also mention that one of the key insights of this book was that they began to push back the dates for which people were understanding these sophisticated astronomical cycles. So here we go. This is again from Hamlet's Mill, and they're talking here about the processional motion. I will mention the processional motion again is one of those things that's better illustrated by images or even video clips. And I will be having a lot of that up on my website, and there's already stuff there. People go to Randall at randallcarlson.com. They can start finding some of the stuff we're talking about. But in this quote here, they're referring to the processional cycle. And what that is I consider that like the third motion of the Earth. The first most obvious motion is the daily, or diurnal is the term, motion of the Earth rotating on its axis, which gives us the day-night cycle. And then the next larger one is the orbit of the Earth, the revolution of the Earth about the sun, which gives us, of course, the yearly cycle. Well, the third motion is this axial motion, of the Earth, that the Earth's axis creates a sort of a geometric form very similar to an hourglass as it's going around. And it is this motion, Richard, that has given us sort of the cliched, you know, the ages, like the age of Pisces, the age of Aquarius, and so on. Because if you think of it this way, if people can visualize this, you've got a sphere with a rod running through the middle. Where it comes out of the top of the Earth, it's the North Pole. Where it comes out at the bottom.
And right now, that's the axis.
If you go out and you look at the night sky, you can find Polaris, which is the North Star. Well, the North Star is in a region in space that's almost directly above where the North Pole points. Okay, but here's the thing. The polar axis is not fixed always. It's moving in this grand circle. So that if we go back halfway through this 26,000-year cycle, the 13,000 years ago, that our North Pole pointed to Vega. Vega would have been the North Star. And if you were trying to navigate somewhere by Polaris, you get hopelessly lost. And then at the same time, the other thing that's moving at that same rate are the equinoxes and the solstices. You know, the equinoxes, you know, we had fall equinox on roughly September 22nd, and then we had winter solstice. Did I say fall equinox? And then winter solstice around December 22nd each year. Then we had we'll be having spring equinox coming up next month. Well, these four positions, which are at right angles to each other, if you could picture a giant cross in space and visualize the wheel of the zodiac, the 12 signs of the zodiac, the equinoxes and the solstices form a gigantic cross that is rotating essentially at the same rate, describing that same circle that the North Polar axis is forming up against the night sky. And what that does is it the point at which the beginning point of this cycle was typically spring equinox, right? When day and night were of the same. Now, this is from cultures that were in the Northern Hemisphere. I want to make that clear. This is which, you know, is pretty much where we've gotten a lot of our data from as far as ancient cultures. Now, we're learning a lot about other cultures from the Southern Hemisphere, and many of the same concepts prevail. We just have to kind of invert things because it's, you know, when it's summer here in Northern Hemisphere, it's winter in the Southern. But it's still the same. They're going to see the same type of motion against the sky that the Northern Hemisphere inhabitants are. So you can picture the vernal equinox is this intersection of these two great planes in space. One is the plane of the ecliptic, which is the Earth's orbital plane around the sun, and the other is the Earth's equatorial plane projected out onto the celestial sphere of stars. Now, because of the fact that the Earth's axis is swinging around in this hourglass geometry, the Earth's equator is not fixed as well. It's moving. It's rotating at the same rate. And what that means is that the point of intersection between the two planes, the celestial equator and the plane of the ecliptic, is moving. And it's moving, and it can be discerned against the night sky if you watch close enough and long enough. And that is exactly what our ancient ancestors did. They were inveterate sky watchers. They obsessively watched the sky. And we see ancient peoples all over the world, same thing, watching the sky tremendous interest and marking these motions, these celestial motions. So now for the last roughly 2,000 years, the vernal equinox, the position of the vernal equinox in the sky has been transiting through the star constellation of Pisces.
Right.
It is now shifting out of that constellation, and in about 300 to 400 years, it'll be moving into the star field that we traditionally refer to or call Aquarius.
Right.
Now,
yes.
You're getting this. I know you know a lot of this already, Richard, but I'm trying to verbally paint a picture for the listeners here. If you take that wheel, the wheel of the zodiac, there's 12 signs in it, right? And that's where we get the 12 signs, Aries, Taurus, Gemini, Cancer, Leo, Virgo, Libra, et cetera, et cetera. all the way around, and we get those 12. Well, the vernal equinox spans, on average, about 2,160 years passing through each sign. Now, if you're counting signs, which are even divisions of the earth, of the zodiacal wheel, they're designated as 30 degrees. And the name given to the signs is the constellation that was in that sign at the time they were given their names, which actually now is around 25, 26, 2700 years ago. So right. What has happened is because of this precessional, and it's precessional, not processional, explain it in a minute, because of this precessional motion, the signs and the constellations that gave their names to the signs have moved apart. And it'll be probably another 24,000, 23,500 years before they line up again. So anyways, this was the concept that that the authors of Hamlet's Mill invoked to as the most likely case for ancient peoples and their concept of the great year cycle. This is the quote now. So again, this is referring to the precessional motion that I just described. The Greek astronomers had enough instrumentation and data to detect this motion, which is immensely slow, and they saw that it applied to the whole of the sky. Hipparchus, in 157 BC, called it the precession of the equinoxes. There is good reason to assume that he actually rediscovered this, and that it had been known some 1,000 years previously, and that on it, the archaic age based its long-range computation of time. The other point that they make, which is important, they go on, this is a little further on in the book, they say there is quite a collection of myths to show that once upon a time it was realized that the
we're kind of losing you there, Randall. Sorry, we just lost you there. Sorry, Randall, we're just losing you a little bit. I don't think
is shot down or removed in some other way. And that was the recognition that, you know, the polar axis of the Earth is drifting. Now, if people want to get a concept or try to get a handle on the rate from the human perspective, think of it this way.
Sorry, Randall, I got to jump in because we're approaching the bottom of the hour here. We'll come back and we'll pick up on this. Continue to explain the precession of the equinoxes and the great year. Randall Carlson is with us. Back with more in a moment. And we are back with Randall Carlson, and we're discussing the great year, this 26,000-year cycle known as the precession of the equinoxes. And so let's just pick up where we left off. We were discussing, you know, how the precession works, the axis that goes through the pole, the South Pole and the North Pole. We sort of can look at that as a pointer, I guess, if we extend that up into the and it's pointing up into the night sky, and we see, you know, these constellations that are connected to the 12 signs of the zodiac. There's kind of a parade, and it takes roughly what, between 2160 years for each zodiac.
On average,
to pass by.
Correct. You got it. So if we go back, let's say three, if we call them, sometimes they're referred to as astrological months, because there's seen this to be this correlation between the 12 months of our solar year and the 12 months, the 12 cosmic months of the precessional year. So just as our annual trip around the sun has 12 months and four seasons, likewise, the greater cycle of precession has 12 months and four seasons. And so if you multiply 2,160, the length of a cosmic month, which is sometimes referred to as a Platonic month after Plato, who wrote about and talked about and studied about these ages and so on. And I'm going to quote from Plato here in a minute. But if you take that cycle, break it into 12 parts, 2,160 years each on average, you come up with a number that actually is fairly deeply embedded into some of the ancient cosmological numbers that we get from the Vedas, that we get from Sumeria, that we get from the Bible, that we get from Mayan traditions. And those numbers tend to be very consistent. And they also show up in sacred writings of many kinds, and they show up in sacred architecture. And that's something that it's going to be difficult to explain without the ability to have visuals for people to see. But one of the things I want to point out here is that I was about to get into trying to bring this down to a human scale so we could try to wrap our heads around that motion of the vernal equinox, which again is correlated with the motion of the poles. And that works out to be 50 seconds of arc per year. Now, how much is that? Well, I think most of the people listening here know that a circle is divided into 360 degrees. Mm-hmm. And each of those degrees is divided into minutes. So there's 60 minutes in a degree, just like there's 60 minutes of time in an hour on the clock. There's 60 minutes of arc in the 1 degree of arc, and then 360 degrees of arc in any full circle. So as it turns out, that motion has been measured by astronomers. Let's see, I have a quote right here. This is from going way back to my astronomy text back in 1975, but it's basically still true, exploration of the universe. The angle through which the equinoxes move each year, the annual precession, is 1/26,000th of 360 degrees, or about 50 seconds. Each year, uh-huh, as the sun completes its eastward revolution about the sky with respect to, say, the vernal equinox, that equinox has moved westward to meet the sun about 50 seconds. Now, if you go out and you look at the full moon in the night sky, or the solar orb as it's just at sunrise or at sunset, that circle, that disk that you see in the sky, and you know that the lunar disk and the solar disk are very, very close to the same size in the sky from our perspective, which is clearly, yes, demonstrated to us during solar eclipses, right?
Yeah, it's miraculous. It's miraculous.
It is quite miraculous, yes. Using either one of those as a measuring stick, we look at the full moon. The distance across that full moon is about 30 minutes of arc. So that if you put two lunar disks together, just touching, tangent is the term, the distance across those two lunar faces would be 1 degree. And that motion of the vernal equinox in the sky takes about 72 years to move, to precess that distance in the sky. So it's not something you would notice if you were just casually watching from year to year. But if you were obsessively watching over the span of about a human lifetime, you would be able to see that there is this motion in the sky. And, you know, the problem is that, you know, if the sun is in the sky at the point you're looking at, the sun's light overwhelms everything else and you can't make very precise observations. But the ancients came up with many ways of sort of workarounds, if you want to consider that. One of those would be watching the cycle of the moon, and because the moon is going to be, it's got a known period of time during which the month occurs. Again, it's pretty simple when you have graphics and can show images and things. It's more difficult to try to describe just with words. But the point is that to an ancient culture that is watching the night sky and watching the position of the sun, where it rises and where it sets throughout the course of the year, is going to be able to discern that motion over the span of about a human lifetime. To me, it's interesting that if you think of it this way, you think of the fact that it takes 72 years to move 1 degree, and approximately, and there are 360 degrees in a circle. You can think of every 72 years being relative, proportional to the great year, the precessional cycle, as 1 day is to our solar year. Does that make sense?
It does. It does.
1 day is to a solar year, so is the 72 years to the precessional cycle. And right now, it's interesting, Richard, that the average span of human life globally is pretty much close to 72 years. So you could think of it this way. An average human lifespan is about 1 day in the cosmic year, give or take, which is kind of an interesting little psychological exercise to integrate your own sense of being into these greater cycles. And that was very much about what the ancient peoples did. Now, let me go on with the next important concept that follows from this. Again, I'm going to go back to quoting Hamlet's Mill here. The twilight of the gods, and this is they're referring here to the Norse tradition, but you know, the Norse tradition had the twilight of the gods, which was corresponding, say, to the apocalypse in the book of Revelation, or many of the other traditions from around the world of global destruction. Okay. The twilight of the gods is understood as the world's end. Yet there is unambiguous testimony to the contrary from the Voluspa and other chapters of the Edda. What actually comes to an end is a world, in the sense of a world age. The catastrophe cleans out the past, which is replaced by a new heaven and a new earth, and ruled by a new pole star. And
the new pole star being, right now it's Polaris. That pole star is replaced every 2,160 years?
Well, no. The new pole stars are going to be relatively irregular. Because, you know, the distribution of the stars in the sky is, you know, it tends to be random rather than an idealized.
Okay, but I think the takeaway here is that we're not talking, as you say, it's not the end, it's more of hit the reset button.
That's a good way to put it, Richard. It's not the ultimate end, it's the hit the reset button. That's exactly right. And I'm gonna jump back to Plato now. And this is a quote from Timaeus, the dialogue, the Platonic dialogue, in which he introduces, you know what?
Atlantis.
Mm. Yep. And so he's describing Solon, who did roughly a 10-year exile, from self-imposed exile from Greece. And during this time, he went to Egypt, and he studied with the priests there in Sais, and he learned about their traditions and found out that they knew a lot about Greek traditions, in fact, more than Solon actually did. And so here now, this is a quote from Timaeus by Plato, and here we go. To this city came Solon, who was received by them with great honor. Now, this is the priesthood. And he asked the priests, who were most skillful in such matters, about antiquity. And he made the discovery that neither he nor any other Hellene, that is Greek, knew anything worth mentioning about the times of old. On one occasion, when Solon was drawing them to speak of antiquity, he began to tell them about the most ancient things in our part of the world, about Phoenicia, who was called the first man, and about Niobe, and after the deluge of the survival of Deucalion and Pyrrha. Now, I will mention that in the Greek myths of the great world-destroying flood, Deucalion or Deucalion and Pyrrha were the two survivors. They were the counterparts of Noah, Israel,
Babylon and Tyre.
Okay, we're kind of losing you, Randall. I don't know what's happening with your phone. It's kind of phasing out.
Of which he was, and to give the dates. Thereupon, one of the priests, who was of a very...
Randall, I don't know if you can hear me, but your phone is cutting out. It's kind of phasing out.
Okay, let me see if I can not have that happen. Let's see.
Okay.
Oh, Solon, is this better?
Yes, much better. So you were talking about that he was being told about the deluge, so the big flood.
Yeah, let me back up there to Deucalion and Pyrrha. We want to get that. They were the counterparts of Noah and his wife. So the priest, so Solon traced the genealogy of their descendants and attempted to reckon how many years old were the events of which he was speaking and to give the dates. Thereupon, one of the priests, who was of a very great age, said, "Oh, Solon, you Hellenes are but children, and there is not an old man who is a Hellene." Solon, hearing this, said, "What do you mean?" The priest replied and said, "I mean to say that in mind you are all young. There is no old opinion handed down among you by ancient traditions, nor any science which is hoary with age. And I will tell you the reason for this. There have been and will be again many destructions of mankind arising out of many causes, but the greatest have been brought about by the agencies of fire and water." And then they go on to say something here that Plato introduces into the dialogue that I think is highly significant. And I continue with the quote here from Timaeus. "There is a story which even you have preserved, that once upon a time, Phaeton, the son of Helios, having yoked the steeds in his father's chariot, but because he was not able to drive them in the path of his father, burned up all that was upon the earth and was himself destroyed by a thunderbolt." Now, this has the form of a myth, but it really signifies a declination of the bodies moving around the earth and in the heavens, and a great conflagration of all things upon the earth recurring at long intervals of time. So that would suggest to me, Richard, that we're talking about some type of a cosmic impact event.
And by fire and by water. So the water would be the deluge, the flood. The fire could be a volcanic eruption, or it could be an asteroid impact.
Yes. And we know now from some of the stratigraphic associations with impact events, like, for example, the KT, a huge amount of the Earth's biomass went up in a gigantic firestorm when the bolide hit the earth that killed the dinosaurs. The same type of thing is being found at the Younger Dryas boundary, that there are deposits of charcoal and evidence of great fires pretty much all over the planet that date to right after 12,900 years ago.
We're coming up onto a break here, top of the hour. We'll come back and continue this discussion, as we'll discover there is this correlation between this cosmic clock, this great year, 26,000 years, and these cycles of cataclysmic events.